Good morning. Greetings from BMS College of Engineering, Bangalore. Today is the second day of our internship on signal processing concepts using Python. So in the beginning, we will do with some theory, and the second half, we will try to execute the same concepts on Python. So we'll start off. How to assignments and quizzes. There is a question regarding assignment and quiz. So as you have seen the schedule, on Saturday we have the first quiz. A quiz or assignment, both are, it's very similar. You will have some questions. It will be on Google form and you will have to answer them. Some of them may be multiple choice, while most of them will be short answers. So you'll have to type out the answer. Sometimes you may have to run the Python code and then write the result. So it is not, it will be based on whatever we are covering for these 3 days. So this is the first. Again, next week we have one more. The last quiz will be slightly different. We are not including any project implementation. That is because we have all passionate people attending the course. You all can take up further activities based on whatever concepts we learn. It will be online and there will be enough time given. Though we lost the quiz around 10 o'clock, it may take you maximum 1 hour to solve the questions. But we will keep it open for at least around 4 to 5 hours, so that even if you have some other commitments or you have some internet issues, you can still answer comfortably without any tension, because here we are looking at learning. It is not an exam, a closed book exam. You can refer to any book. You can do a Google search, try to get the answer and then solve it. So that's how we plan. And so nothing to get worried. Most of you will be able to do it well, as long as you are attending the session. It will be based on what we are covering on these days. So it's not a closed book, not a Viva. It's an open book. In any internship, do you write any fixed exams in any internship? I'm sure most of you have taken up internships in various organizations. You go get to know the organization. You learn by experience. You refer to documents. You read, and then you get an experience. It's very similar to that here. Slightly different. That's it. So today. It's the 16th September. I will also be sharing this file. This is what we are writing. We write on this pad, and it doesn't, the pen doesn't move so well, and so the handwriting will be, you will get used to my handwriting in 1 or 2 days. My students are all used to my handwriting. But yes, because it's not that you can see the handwriting and write the content. It is just you listen to what I'm saying and you'll be able to write. This is just a support. So this is the second day. And today what we are going to focus on is we will see what is known as the basic signals. Basic signals. And mostly we are looking at continuous time, so analog, because this course is on analog signals. We will see. So when we plot, we will also see how to plot a corresponding discrete time signals. So we will take up different signals just in case, I request you to help me in case I forget out some. So we will start with the unit impulse function. Then we will take up the unit step function. Then we will see the unit ramp function. Next we shall see the exponential function, e to the power of at. Then we shall see the complex exponential, e to the power of j omega t. Then maybe sine omega t, the sine omega t, cos omega t, etc., the trigonometric functions. We will also see a function known as the signum function. We shall see the sinc function. These are all functions that we come across in signal processing. In addition, I thought we will also take up the sine hyperbolic function, sine hyperbolic, cos hyperbolic, and the tan hyperbolic functions. We will have a look at another function which is known as the sigmoid function, and then later on we will try to sketch the Gaussian probability function, maybe the uniform probability function, and say the exponential function, the exponential probability density function. So today we are just going to see the how these functions look like, and we will try to plot. And just to see, just to go a little beyond, all, I mean, we have students from different semesters attending. We have a wide spectrum of audience in this program. So I thought we'll also include an example on say cos A plus B, cos A plus B, and you know the expansion of cos A plus B. And we will try to see it, and we will see some very interesting result when we take up the plot in the Python code in the later half. So this is what I have planned for today. So we will first try to plot using paper and pen, and later on we will do it in the code. Both this file as well as the Python code will be shared with you after the session. Recording, just give me some time. I'm working out. I will check it out. So unit impulse function is something all of us must have heard of. Delta t in mathematics, probably you must have called it as the Dirac delta function, and delta t. And if I try to plot this function as a function of time, this is how we draw it. Like, it's an arrow. We terminate an impulse in a continuous time signal. Whenever we plot, we terminate it by an arrow. And what does it mean? It actually implies it is such that it has a very narrow width and a very large amplitude, such that the whole area is one. That's how it is viewed. And let's not go into the complex mathematical definition of this function, but if you look at impulse function, what is an impulse function? If we want to know, it is like something that is almost zero continuous. Suddenly it becomes high, and immediately it becomes zero. So I repeat it. It is zero always. It suddenly becomes very high, and immediately it comes back to a zero. So that is what we call an impulse function. It's something like, say I take a hand and I hit myself and remove. So then what is that? I have given an impulse to myself. So that's an example. But it's not a force. It's a signal whose strength goes high and comes down. And now, if you ask me, do impulse functions exist? All of us have lab. In the lab, you might have seen signal generators. Signal generators will generate a sine function, a sinusoidal signal. You have a pulse generator. You have a rectangular wave generator. You have a triangular wave generator. Is there anyone here in the audience, among the participants, who has in the lab an impulse generator? Do we have any college which has an impulse generator in your department, labs? Yes, do we have any? You must have seen in the lab you have a signal generator. signal generator will generate sine wave, triangular wave, sawtooth, rectangular, etc. Do you have an impulse generator in your labs? Yes or no? Anyone? Anyone? Yes, any answers? The answer is no, because an impulse, actually an ideal impulse, does not exist. Impulse doesn't exist. It doesn't exist physically. It exists in textbooks. It will exist when the teacher teaches the course, and it will be there in textbooks. But in a lab, you will not have an impulse function. And we will also try to sketch. Suppose I want to sketch, say, delta t minus 2. What does it mean? Now what is delta t? What is delta t? Delta t is a 1 at t equal to 0. At t equal to 0. So take the argument and equate it to 0. And at what value does it become t equal to 0? And hence it's a 1. Applying the same logic, if I want to sketch delta t minus 2, what should I do? I take the argument. What is the argument? T minus 2. Put t minus 2 equal to 0. What will I get? What's the value of 2? Very good. Very good. T equal to 2. So where is my impulse now? Delta t minus 2, where does it exist? It is going to exist at t equal to 2. Because if this is 0, we know the left hand side is a negative time, a positive time, and this is t equal to. Very good. Thank you. And whoever has responded has no name. So thank you. Thank you. Please log in with your names, because I would like to call you out by name. Yes. Similarly, if I want to plot, let us say, 2 times delta t plus 3. How do I plot it? How do I plot it? Again, I am going to put my argument. What's my argument? T plus 3. And equate it to 0. What will I get? What is the value of T now? When I put T plus 3 equal to 0? Yes, very good. Very good. T equal to minus 3. So at, yes, thank you. Yes, very good. Very good. So at T equal to minus 3. And what is the amplitude? Normally it would have been 1. But because there is a multiply by 2, this is going to be magnitude of 2. Magnitude of 2. So this is how we can sketch a little amplitude, amplitude scaling, or a time shift, a right shift, a left shift, etc. This is the unit impulse function. So similarly, let's take up, and I repeat, impulse functions do not exist physically. Physically, they will not exist. You can have a pulse generator, but not an impulse function. And ironically, if you look at time domain analysis, I don't know how many of you have already taken the course on signals and systems, or any analog signal processing course. You will have a complete course on impulse response. Impulse itself doesn't exist, but the whole course will be on impulse response. So it becomes too mathematical and very abstract to imagine. And that is why we have at the end of this, let us see. Okay, that we will see in the lab sessions that we have planned. We also have some experiments to see the impulse response of a system. We will check that. So next we will go to the next signal, and that is the unit step function. And what is unit step function? U of t equal to 1 for t greater than or equal to 0, and 0 for t less than 0. And so if I try to plot u of t, this is how it is going to be. Please have a separate notebook please draw it. Yes, so this is how it is. It is 0 before, and then it takes a value 1. So this is my unit step function. A unit step function. Again, how do I define my unit step function? Take the argument. It is 1 for the argument greater than or equal to 0. It is 0 for argument less than 0. That's how we have to interpret it, or I like to interpret it in that manner. So going by the same logic, if I want to draw, say, u of t minus 1.5. What should I do? What should I do? This is going to be one for the argument. What is the argument? Argument is t minus 1.5 greater than or equal to 0. So what does this give me now? This is going to be one. It's going to be one for the argument greater than or equal to 0. So t minus 1.5 greater than or equal to 0. So what is the value of t? T should be greater than or equal to, yes, so what we get? T is, yes, t is greater than or equal to 1.5. So then what happens now? I will take my t. Very good, very good. We are having only three or four of them answering. We have I look forward to more active participation. So t equal to 1.5. What happens for argument greater than or equal to 0? The value is 1. 1. And hence, yes. And hence, this is how we get. So how, what does it mean? It is 0 throughout. At 1.5, it jumps to 1 and it remains at 1 throughout. It remains at 1 throughout. So this is what is u of t minus 1.5. Similarly, if I try to draw, let us say, 2 times u of t plus 3. So who can tell me what's the answer? What's the answer? For t, yes. So take the argument. Very good. Argument is t plus 3. For t plus 3 greater than or equal to 0, the value of the function is going to be 1, and hence take so that is going to give me t is greater than or equal to minus 3, and go to minus 3, and normally it is going to be 1, but because I have a 2 here, it is going to be this. So it's going to be a signal of strength 2. Now my next question is, do you think we have the unit step function in the lab? Do we have in our laboratories, do we have a step function? Yes or no? Do we have step functions in the lab? Do we have a step generator in the lab? Does it exist? Does a unit step function, as a unit impulse, doesn't exist? Does a unit step function, does it exist? Yes or no? Practically, yes, it exists. I take a DC value, and let us say I have some resistor, and if I close this at say t equal to 0, what I am getting is a step function. If this is my voltage of say 1 volt, then at t equal to 0, the signal that I apply becomes a unit step function. Can someone help tell me describe what do you think is this signal? U of t plus 2 minus u of t minus 1. What do you think it will be? Just describe it. I will draw it directly. What do you think will be u of t plus 2 minus u of t minus 1? Yes. What's the value? Any answers? What is u of t plus 2 minus u of t minus 1? Yes, rectangular function. Yes, rectangular from what values of time? For what duration in time? Yes, very good. So u of t plus 2, very good. U of t plus 2 is going to be 1 for minus 2 onwards. And then I have at t equal to 1, this is going to be, so when I do the subtraction, this is what I will get. This is what I get. So this is going to be 1 in the interval minus 2 to plus 1. Very good, very good. We'll take one more example before proceeding. Can we try to draw this signal? Say u of t plus 2 plus u of t plus 1 plus u of t minus 1 minus 3 times u of t minus 2. If I try to draw this, what will I get? At t plus 2, that is minus 2, then minus 1, then 1, and then 2. So here I have a 1, then I have another 1, and then I have another 1. At t equal to, I have another 1, and it proceeds, and then I have a minus 3. Am I right? Is it right? U of t plus 2? Yes, plus 1. Then this one, and then a minus 3. Yes. So this is how using. Yes.
Ma'am, for u of t plus 1, it should be like one only, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. I will answer that. So yes. So our question is like yes. First, I need to draw u of t plus 2. What is u of t plus 2? Okay, then I have u of t plus 1. What is u of t plus 1? Next, I have u of t minus 1. And what is u of t minus 1? Now add all of them. When I add all of them, what will I get? In the interval minus 2 to minus 1, it is going to be 1. How about if I add all these three signals in the interval minus 1 to 0, what happens? 1 plus 1. How much is 1 plus 1? 2. And it remains 2. Till where does it remain 2? It remains 2. Even if I add here also, it remains 2. But the moment I reach my time of plus 1, then what happens? I have 1 plus 1 plus 1. So it is 3. It is 3. Then afterwards, what I have, I am having u of t minus 2. But magnitude is 3. And if I take u of t minus plus 2, the magnitude being 3. So here I have 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 3, and then a minus 3. Minus 3, and hence this is what I get. So 1, here it is 1 plus 1 for this interval, then 1 plus 1 plus 1, so it is 3, then plus 3 minus 3, and so we have a 0. Is it right? Are you convinced?
Yes, ma'am.
Please interrupt this way. Yes, that because you have asked, but I'm sure many others also might have had the doubt. So that is it. Yes. So we have seen unit impulse. We have seen the unit step function. And now let us take up the next one, which is the ramp. Ramp function. And this is given by R of t. R of t. And this is t for t greater than or equal to 0, and 0 for t less than 0. And hence, if I try to plot it, It is 0 for t less than 0. Suppose t is 1, then the ramp function is also 1. So 1, 1. Suppose t is 2, the ramp function is also 2. And hence this is what I get, the unit ramp function. So this is the ramp function, which is t for t greater than or equal to 0. Is that fine? So next signal that we will take up is the sine and cosine. I think I'm not sure whether I should draw them. Sine and cos. Say sine. If I want to draw, say sine 2 pi t. If I want to draw sine 2 pi t, let us say t. T equal to 1. T equal to 1. What's the value of sine of 2 pi? Sine 2 pi? Yes. So this is 1. T equal to 0, also 1. T equal to half? T equal to half? Also 0. So t equal to half is also 0. T equal to 1 by 4. T equal to 1 by 4 will give me sine pi by 2. And that is going to be a 1. Very good. Very good. So this is how it is. And similar, this is for t equal to 1 by 4. And this is for t is 3 by 4. And what we have is this is a 1. And sine, this is how it is. Yes, it's not looking so good. That's why when we draw in the tool, it is going to be very nice. This curve is not drawn so well. But this is a sine function. Similarly, you know to draw the cosine function, sine and cos. My next question is, suppose I give a question, like I want you to please go and generate a sine wave of frequency, say 1 kilohertz. Or if I say generate a sine wave of say 100 hertz. Can you generate it in the lab? Can you do it, or have you visited the lab and have you seen sine generators? Do these sinusoidal signals exist? Can we see it? Can we see it in the sense we can't see an electrical signal? We need an oscilloscope to see it. How many of you have actually visited the lab because of COVID time? First and second year students, most of them have not seen the lab only. That's very painful, but yes. Yes. So we have a Pankaj telling, yes, we can generate a sine wave, and we have seen a sine wave. Has anybody seen, maybe in your plus two in your school days or after coming to the physics lab in the engineering college, have you seen tuning forks? Have you seen the tuning fork? The tuning fork? Yes. You have seen a tuning fork, and then you hit the tuning on the tuning fork, some frequency will be mentioned. And when you hit the tuning fork and when you keep it near your ear, you can hear it. You can hear the tuning fork. The frequency is mentioned on the tuning fork, and these tuning forks generate pure sine waves. The tuning forks generate pure sine waves, and that's how they are designed. So sinusoidal signals are generated by the tuning forks, and you can also generate it. I'm sure some of you must have already done some oscillator circuits in your lab or in some course, and so we can generate sinusoidal signals. So this is physically realizable; they exist. And to see it, we may need an oscilloscope, but they exist. We can generate. Next question, next type of signal, if I take the basic signal, let us say, let's take an interesting signal. Let us say e bar minus t. E to the power of minus t minus the exponential signal of and multiplied by say ut. I have a signal. Yes, crystal oscillator. Very good answer. Very good. Yes, crystal oscillators also produce sinusoidal signals. Very good. Thank you, Lakshmi. Yes. So sinusoidal signals in nature, I mean, a power like frequency, the power signals that we get is 50 hertz sinusoidal. So sine waves are something that just exist naturally in many physical devices. Yes. So now e power minus t ut, if I take, let me try to, because of presence of ut, what happens? It exists only for t greater than or equal to zero. Now I need your help in calculating. Put t equal to 1, put t equal to 2, put t equal to 3 and tell me the answer. And if you are good in, or you can simply go to Python and simply type np.e and you will get the value of this. Yes, you can try this as well. Please give me. For t equal to 0, who can tell me the answer? What is the value of this function for t equal to 0? For t equal to 0, yes, e power minus 0, that is a 1. For t equal to 0, it's a 1. For t less than 0, for t less than 0, it's a 0. For t less than 0, it's a 0. For t equal to 1, for t equal to 1, please tell me what's the value. For t equal to 1, e to the power of minus 1, please check out your calculators, compute it and give me the value. Yes, I've got one answer, one right answer. I'm looking for some more answers. Yes, yes. Yes. Yes, but yes. So when I put t equal to 1, e to the power of minus 1, if you take your calculator and compute it, you're going to get the value as 0.36. Then put t equal to 2. Please put t equal to 2 and tell me what's the value, e power minus 2. Yes, 0.13. Put t equal to 3. Yes. Put t equal to 3, 0.049. Okay. And so this is how it is. It decreases again when we plot in Python. We will have a correct exponential decrease. Now, because I'm drawing without a graph paper, just a freehand sketch, so it will not be so perfect. But we know that it's an exponentially decreasing function. Please tell me what is the value for t equal to 10? E power minus 10. For t equal to 10, how much is it? Yes, they are giving us 0.000045. Yes, why I'm asking this is, can we tell that it is almost zero? It's almost zero when t equal to 10. Can I tell that e power minus 10, 10 is almost zero? E power minus 10 is almost zero. Do we agree to that? Yes. How much is infinity? How much is at t equal to infinity? How much is e power minus infinity? How much is e power minus infinity? It is zero. So now here there's a very interesting observation. E power minus infinity is zero, but e power minus 10 is almost zero. So I draw a very interesting conclusion that for the given function t equal to 10, t equal to 10 is almost equal to infinity. I hope you're appreciating what I'm trying to convey here. The value of the signal tends to zero at t equal to infinity. The value of the signal is almost zero at t equal to 10. And hence, I can consider t equal to 10 as equivalent to infinity. As equivalent to infinity. So you must have seen, you must have heard the term time constant, 10 times the time constant, 5 times the time constant, etc. That is how it draws this. That's how we draw this conclusion. And if someone is interested, you can refer to the book by Sheng on signals. On signals and systems, and there he gives a very good presentation of discussion of this infinity getting related to zero. Now I have another question. Suppose my another signal, let us say my x of t is e to the power of minus 0.2 t ut. E to the power of minus 0.2 t ut. Then for what value of t you would like to, how do we compare the result with the earlier result? We know that this is going to decay more slowly. Can you tell me what is the value of t equal to 1, t equal to 2? Of course, t equal to 0 will still be a 1. How much is it for t equal to 1? Yes, 0.88, and then you will have some other value. So what has happened? The decay is slow. Can you tell when do you think, I said e power minus 10 is approximately equal to 0. So when do I get this as 0.2 t as 10? So what should be the value of t to be considered as infinity in this case? It's t10. Right?
50.
Yes, 50. T equal to 50 if I do, then I will get it as. So my time constant has reduced. My exponential decay is a little bit slow. So when t equal to 50, I can consider it is approximately equal to infinity, or you can relate it to what in some certain courses you have come across the steady state response. It reaches the steady state response after a time of about 50. So the t, the what is the value of t that we can equate it to infinity, consider almost equal to infinity, depends on the value of a. So e power minus 80 if I take. It depends on the value of e. Okay, so now next signal we will take. I think the number is 6. Maybe going wrong in the numbers. So let's take another very extremely interesting signal, the complex exponential, e to the power of j omega t. E power j omega t, from the Euler's expression, we know that this is cos omega t. Plus j plus j sine omega t. Now my question is, can we generate this signal in the lab? Can we generate, you said sinusoidal signals, everybody said we can generate it. Someone said crystal oscillator, and then I said the tuning fork, and we all said we can generate the sinusoidal signal. I'll give you the value of omega. Let us say omega can be 10, omega can be 100, say 5 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz. Now, yes. Shashank says, yes, very good. Very good. So, very good. Shashank is quoting my own answer, which I said yesterday. And if suppose somebody, you join a job or you go somewhere, and someone, or in the interview, they ask you, please give me the circuit to generate e power j omega t. then you have to be so happy that this signal cannot be generated. This cannot be generated. It doesn't exist. This doesn't exist at all. And it is that is why we say it is complex. We complex in the sense, not in the complexity of the system, not that it's a huge system. It's complex, or actually it is imaginary. This is the real part, and this is the imaginary part. And what is imaginary? Something that we imagine in the mind. It doesn't exist. We just imagine. So this complex exponential, and how do we plot it? If I want to plot, I can plot the real part of the signal as cos. I can plot the imaginary part of the signal as sine. I can give two plots, real and imaginary. Or I can plot it as magnitude and phase. What's the magnitude of the signal? I can plot it as magnitude and put it in the polar form. Who can tell me what is the magnitude of the signal? Cos omega t. Well, how do I get the magnitude? Square root of cos square. Yes, magnitude will be a 1, and the angle will be omega. So I can plot it as, I cannot plot like all other signals. I was able to plot it using a single plot, because we know that signals are single valued function of time. But this is not a signal. This is a complex exponential, and it doesn't exist. It has no physical significance. It exists in textbooks. It exists in communication textbooks. It exists in the mind. It exists in mathematics textbooks. But it does not exist in reality. Nowhere we can have a physical system where we can have e power cos omega t plus j sine omega t. So because these do not exist, any communication system, you speak of 5G, any communication, electromagnetic waves in free space, everything is real. Everything is real. And now can someone tell me, why do we have this complex signals then? Why do we have the complex exponential? It is simply because it is of its mathematical convenience. Mathematical convenience. Like people like me, I find it easy to integrate or differentiate e power j theta as compared to integrating cos or sine. I can multiply, I can add. Everything is easier for me to do in the e power j theta than in cosine or sine. And that is why, just because of mathematical convenience, we have this introduced, this term J, and the complex term introduced, or an imaginary term. It's always better to use the word imaginary than complex. Complex has two meanings, or like something very complicated or very huge or very difficult to understand. It is not in that aspect, because this is purely because something is imaginary. So this is so please remember, sometimes people forget, and sometimes you come across publications also where people do with the complex signal, and they have block diagrams, and they get a complex output, and that doesn't exist at all. Yes, next we will take a function, the signum function, which is defined, it is again useful sometimes. It is 1 for t greater than 0, and say minus 1 for t less than 0. You can probably tell it is 0 for t equal to 0. Yes. Can we draw this? Yes. It's another function, the signum function, which is 1. Which is 1 for t greater than 0, and it is minus 1 for t less than 0. And at t equal to 0, we can take it as 0. Now I have a question. I want you to draw the signal 1 plus one plus signum of t. Please draw this signal, and and then draw the signum 1 plus signum of t and whole thing divide by 2. Please do and tell me what do you get. Draw the signal 1 plus signum of t and divide the whole answer by 2. By 2. Yes. Yes, 0. Yes. What happens when t is greater than 0? Yes. What is that function? What is it that we are getting? What is this function? Very good. I've got one right answer. I'll wait for some more time. I know some more are trying. Please try it. Otherwise, you can also draw and send it on, share the figure on WhatsApp in case you want to know how it is. That's how we used to do our classes. The students used to share. Very good. Very good. We got a second right answer. A second right answer. Yes. Very good. So what we have is 1 plus signum function. When I add and divide it by 2, it becomes a unit step function. Because if I add here 1 plus minus 1, it is a 0. For t less than 0. For t greater than 0, 1 plus 1, it's a 2. 2 divided by 2. 2 divided by 2 is a 1. So then I get a unit step function. So this relation is very, very useful. Sometimes you will find it nice. So now, similarly, the other is also valid. Just check if the other, if I just do some algebra, signum of t is going to be 2 times u of t minus 1. Please check whether you get it. Just algebra, 2 times u of t minus 1. Do I get the signum function? Yes. Yes. So we have seen another important function, the signum function, going to be useful in some applications. So now we'll take the next signal. Another extremely important signal, which we come across very often in our communication and many courses, and that is the sync function. Sync, let us say sync omega t. Sync omega t is given by sine omega t by omega t. Sine omega t by omega t. And for example, let us take a specific example. Let us say sync say 2 pi t. What will this be? This will be sine 2 pi t divided by 2 pi t. And let us try to draw this. If you look at, we just now drew sine 2 pi t. How was sine 2 pi t? When did I at t equal to half, what was the value? Look at t equal to half. I will define. This is a sync function. It's a sine x by x. We call it a sine x by x. And just take the value, let us say t equal to half. Please take the value t because it's a very important function. We will spend a little more time, on this function. T equal to half. What is sine 2 pi t equal to half sine pi? How much is sine pi? 0. 0 by 0 by half, t is half. So what happens? It's a 0. Similarly, tell me what is the value at t equal to 1? At t equal to 1. At t equal to 1, sine 2 pi, it's a 0. So it is 0 at half, it is 0 at 1. I'm sure you will agree that it is 0 at minus half. Minus half, and it is 0 at minus 1 also. It is 0 at minus 1 also. Please tell me what is the value at 1 by 4. At t equal to 1 by 4, nothing to worry. Put t equal to 1 by 4, sine pi by 2. How much is sine pi by 2 is 1. 1 divided by. See, if I want to calculate. No, it is not 1. It is not 1. At t equal to 1 by 4, what happens? My numerator is sine 2 pi, t is 1 by 4. So 2 pi by 4. Divided by 2 pi by 4. And how much is sine 2 pi by 4? Sine pi by 2 is a 1. And 2 pi by 4 becomes a pi by 2. How much is 2 by pi? Okay, I'm getting an answer as 0.63. 0.63. You will agree that it will be even for t equal to minus 1 by 4, we will get the same 0.63. 0.63. Next, tell me similarly, put the value of t as 3 by 4. Put the value of t as 3 by 4 and tell me what's the answer. What's the value? Put t equal to 3 by 4. So what you will have? Put t equal to 3 by 4. So you will get, you need to compute sine 2 pi t is 3 by 4 divided by again 2 pi. 2 pi 3 by 4. Please compute and get the value. Yes. I am getting one answer as minus 0.2. Is it right or wrong? Please confirm. Please confirm. Is it right? Yes. So let us take it is right. Now what's the value for t equal to 0? Can someone tell me what's the value for t equal to 0? For t equal to 0, what's the value? What's the value for t equal to 0? Have you heard of a rule known as the L'Hopital rule? Yes, apply this rule and then tell me what is the value at t equal to 0. You differentiate the numerator, differentiate the denominator, substitute the value and get the answer. You need to apply a rule known as the L'Hopital rule and get the answer. Please apply this rule for t equal to 0 and then tell me what's the value at t equal to 0. Yes, everyone, yes, I got one right answer. Some more, if you don't know, please refer to the textbook or whenever you were introduced to this rule known as the L'Hopital rule. Apply it and get the answer, and then when you do that, you will get the answer as 1. So at t equal to 0, it is going to be a 1. It's a 1. And so when I try to plot, this is what I get. You can compute further values and you will get it. So how is it? It's a sine function whose magnitude keeps on reducing as time increases, because you're having a t on the denominator. We know to draw only sine 2 pi t. You draw sine 2 pi t, and after drawing sine 2 pi t, you divide it by 2 pi t. So then you're dividing by something. So it's a sine function which keeps decreasing in magnitude. So this is known as a sine function, and it's very, very important, because it's a very important signal, because so many situation we will come across this function known as the sync function. So for communication engineers, for electronics engineers, for all of us, the sync function is extremely useful. Like if you, yes, we will see some applications later, but this is what we have. So it is a sine function whose magnitude keeps decreasing as time increases. So this is how we have. And you remember, usually a sine function, is it odd or even? And how is my sync function? Is this odd or an even function? Is it even or odd function? How do you find this function? Is it an even function of time or an odd function of time? Yes, it is even. Normally, how is sine function? Normally, sine is an odd function. Because sine is odd, t is odd, odd by odd, so we got an even function. So we got an even function. So the sync function is an even function. So next, and another important, how do I know it has zero crossings? Where is my first zero crossing? Equate the argument. What is the argument here? Argument is 2 pi t. Equate the argument to pi. Equate the argument to pi. 2 pi t equal to pi. What will I get t equal to? If I equate the argument to pi, what is my t equal to? Equate the argument to pi, and what will I get? T equal to? Yes, t equal to half. And why do I need to do this? Then I have my first zero crossing. I have my first zero crossing at half, and then multiples of half. So zero crossings occur at multiples of half. So in general, now if I want to define, if I want to plot my sync function, let us say I have sync omega t, and we know that this is nothing but sine omega t by omega t. And what happens is, this is going to have a 1 at t equal to 0, and multiples, it's going to have zero crossings, evenly spaced, a function of time. And where is my zero crossing? At the argument equal to pi. So omega t equal to pi, put the argument omega t equal to pi, and then what will I get t? T as pi by omega. So I have my first zero crossing at pi by omega, second zero crossing at 2 pi by omega, and so on. And it is even, it's an even function of t. So now quickly I want you to draw and share the result with me, or let us say sync. Please sketch sync pi t. Sync pi t. Please sketch sync pi t. This at t equal to 0, it's a 1. Please tell me, where is my zero crossing? Where is my first zero crossing? Where is my first zero crossing? Yes, first zero crossing is at 1, so second zero crossing will be at 2, the third zero crossing will be at 3. So minus 1, minus 2, and so on. Is that fine? Yes. Yes, we will just, we have more or less covered all the signals that we cover in communication, but I also wanted to do some more examples. Can someone tell me what is cos of A plus B? We will do it directly in Python. What is cos A plus B? What is cos A plus B? It's got nothing to do with signal, but we will put in some signal component in the example we take up. Yes. Cos A, cos B, minus sin A, sin B. So we will check this. We will try to do this as one example. Yes, very good. Very good. So these are not exactly signals, but just certain additional examples that we're going to see in the lab session. Next, let us say I have, does anyone remember the expression for a Gaussian distribution? The Gaussian distribution, say f of x, 1 by something e to the power of 1 by sigma root of 2 pi e to the power of x minus mu whole square by 2 sigma square. This is another Gaussian distribution. What is mu and what is sigma? What is mu and what is sigma? Are you aware of it or? Yes, mean and standard deviation. Yes, perfectly right. Yes. So this is going to be centered around the mu. And this is the standard deviation. X, and we can, instead of x, I can simply have it as a function of time. Because we again come across Gaussian distributions very often. So that is the reason. And it will have some value at x equal to 0. You can compute the value. The value is going to be 1 by sigma root of 2 pi. And then again, there is some term multiplied here. So this is the Gaussian distribution. We will have a look at this also when we try to plot. There's one more function we will be trying to plot. And that is, does anyone remember the expression for tan hyperbolic x? Tan hyperbolic x. Does anyone remember the expression for tan hyperbolic x? E to the power of. You can Google and check and tell me. Just do a Google search on tan hyperbolic x and tell me what's the answer. E power x. We will try to plot this function also. Am I right or wrong? At least do a Google search and tell me, am I right or wrong? A tan hyperbolic function, is this right or wrong?
Ma'am, it's e power x minus e power minus x.
Numerator?
Numerator is minus and denominator is plus 1.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Yes. Minus and plus. And this another function we'll try to plot. And there's one more function known as the sigmoid function. Can someone look and tell me what is the expression for the sigmoid function? Please check, is this right or wrong? The sigmoid function. You can just type, do a Google search and check what is sigmoid function, sigmoid of x.
Yes, ma'am, it's correct.
Right, yes. So we will try to plot these functions. Because we have few participants who are from the computer science domain, and they will be needing this tan hyperbolic function and sigmoid function when they implement a neural network in the last output layer. You are going to have these functions that are going to help in making the decision. So since anyway we are just learning to plot functions, we can plot signals as well as some functions. That's why we'll take up all these examples in the plot. So now the time is 11:10. We'll meet at 11:30 and we'll start trying to do these functions in the Python. We'll try to plot. So we'll take a short break and we'll come back at 11:30. Any doubts, any questions?